You're watching CTOM TV. Knowledge is power.
Thank you very much for this very useful session.
You're welcome.
Welcome.
Yeah, I am a practitioner myself, and the cancer patient is my husband, actually.
Okay, great.
And he don't want to do anything with his condition. You just go and take the medication and come back. That's it, okay?
Right. How long ago was he diagnosed, Amna?
Yeah, so we'll come to that, yeah. And I'm taking care of the rest, okay? And actually, my husband was diagnosed in September 2018,
okay.
Which is now he hit his third anniversary this month, last month.
Great.
Okay, and my husband worked with the United Nations and he worked overseas.
Okay.
So one day he just called me, he was coughing, he's a smoker.
Okay.
And he was traveling in different countries. He was coughing, and I thought it's just like a cough, you know, like you don't have to worry about it. Okay. And one day he called me from Africa, and he told me he coughed some blood.
Oh.
Okay. So next day he had his chest X-ray, and they find the lump on his upper left lobe.
Okay.
And then he took a plane and he came to Canada same day. Okay. We are in Ottawa now. Okay, and we start the journey from there. He has been diagnosed, and he has KRAS mutation.
KRAS?
Yeah, KRAS mutation. Yeah, okay. And at that time, there is no medication for that, target medication or anything.
Do you know what mutation he has?
KRAS, let me get you the numbers here. Just 1 second.
Okay.
And the one they got the targeted medication for it recently, it is the same one. He started on a combo chemotherapy plus the immunotherapy from the get-go.
Okay, was that the pemetrexed?
Yeah,
pemetrexed, yeah. Radiation and
not radiation at that time. No, not radiation. It is two chemotherapies.
Okay, so it's a platinum drug and pemetrexed.
Yeah, exactly, and the Keytruda.
Okay.
Okay, and at that time they find one of his lymph nodes also infected.
Okay.
So he has been shifted, like he was not operable at that point. Okay, and the other things on the right lung, they find small spots, okay. Very small spots. Okay, scattered around the whole lung.
Okay.
They did a lavage, and the lavage came negative.
Okay.
But still, they were not sure if that is cancerous or not cancer.
Mm.
So he was not, he deemed inoperable, and they tried to put him on the medication. Okay. At that time, we did the brain, bone, name it. There is no metastasis or anything.
Okay, good.
So anyway, actually he had a very good, really very good response to the medications.
Was he high PD-1?
It is intermediate.
Intermediate, okay.
Intermediate, so like 50% exactly.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, so, but he responded very well, okay, and the lump shrunk. When he was diagnosed, it was 4.9, and then it came down to 0.7 centimeters.
Ah, great.
Okay, and he was asymptomatic. He actually had the least side effects from the medication.
Wonderful.
Okay, so he already did very well and everything went well, okay? Mm-hmm. And last year, September last year, he felt dizzy.
Mm.
Okay, he felt dizzy and headache and all these things. We went to emergency and with dizziness and headache, and they find a lump on his brain.
Okay.
They did a surgery next day.
Mm-hmm.
They took the lump. The lump is down there on the.
Okay.
And they took it all. It was very successful surgery, and they find very small spot on his temporal lobe.
Okay.
So they did the radiation. After that, they did it to the surgery site, and at the same time to that spot on his temporal.
Okay.
Okay. The surgery went very well. He was fine. He was not dizzy. Everything was fine.
Okay.
Okay. And then they follow up with him with every 3 months MRI for his head.
Yeah.
Okay, and at the same time, every 3 months, CT scan for his lung. Mm-hmm. And at that point, he hit the 2 years of chemotherapy, immunotherapy, so they stopped it. Okay, and he had no whatever symptoms for the lung cancer. He was not coughing. He's doing very well.
Okay.
Okay, but this brain things really shocked us.
Yes.
Okay, and then they told us it is the same kind of tumor from the lung. I'm not sure if they did the mutation or not from your session today, but when they told us it is the same tumor, I assume that they did the genetics, but today I'm going to check with his doctor after this session, definitely, if they did the genetics or not.
Okay.
Yeah. And last MRI, which was 6 weeks ago, or 5 weeks ago, they find also a small spot on the foramen magnum.
Okay.
Small spot there, and you know the proximity of the spine and everything, so we just got worried. And they did a radiation therapy for it. They radiated. It is very small. It is 4 millimeters, but the doctor decided to do the cyber knife, and they radiated.
Okay.
And we are waiting for another MRI to see if there is anything new in the brain on the 20th of this month.
Okay.
The thing is that the small temporal one, it got treated totally with the MRI, with the cyber knife. When the MRI, it is not showing or anything.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, so for now, he's not in any medication.
Yeah.
For the time being, he's not in any medication. Clinically, he's doing fine.
Yeah.
His blood work is excellent. And actually, his blood work is always excellent. He never had any abnormalities on his blood all this time throughout the last 3 years. Okay, now he's in no medication. We're just waiting for this MRI. My question is just, are we missing anything here? Is there anything we can do?
Yes, there's a lot. Yes, there is a lot.
Last time I discussed with the doctor, I discussed with him this new medication for the KRIS, target medication for it. And he told me he doesn't need it now, but it is something we can put in our back pocket. If we need it, we can use it. But at the same time, he told me that one is the maximum, I'm not sure of this research result. He told me the maximum benefit of it is maybe like 1 year or so, so far.
Right, so far, yeah.
So
does he have the C mutation then? It only works for the C mutation.
Same, yeah, because he told me it worked for that mutation. I don't have my book right in front of me now. But he told me this medication works for your husband. But as long as he's doing fine now, we are not going to use it. We are going to just wait if he needs it in the future.
Okay. So there are a few things. First off, in dealing with a brain metastasis, I know an excellent doctor in your area. He's actually in Toronto, just a wonderful human being and just an amazing doctor. And he does something called the Nico Myriad Brain Path Surgery. I don't know if you are aware of that, but it was actually developed in Ottawa. Now it's in the States. There's not a lot of Canadian doctors trained in this type of surgery, but what it is...
What is his name?
I'll give you that afterwards. We can discuss this. I can call him and ask if he can help you out too. He's a friend of mine and just a wonderful individual. So what he does is he does a kind of, you can Google this. It's called the Nico Myriad Brain Path.
Just hold on, please. 1 second.
It's a type of surgery.
Actually, my husband surgery has been done by Dr. Sinclair.
Okay.
I'm not sure.
So he's had the brain path? Did he have the Nico Myriad brain path surgery?
I don't know what kind of surgery it is.
Okay, well, this is what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the Nico Myriad brain path surgery.
What is that surgery? Can you give me...
Okay, it's a special type of surgery that uses a very small incision, and it can go anywhere in the brain, even into the brainstem in some circumstances, but it's really good for deep-seated tumors that can't be taken out through normal surgery procedures. And basically what it is it's a process where they create a path through the convoluted folds of the brain called the sulcans, and then they create this corridor, and they insert this very thin little tube in there, and it sucks the tumor out right there. And the tumor has a cutting head that it's internalized, so it does. So they can work next to blood vessels and major nerves and so on, and they can go places in the brain that no other surgeons can go. And it's a specialized tool. So I have a friend in Toronto who is a leading doctor in the surgery, and I can hook you up with him. And if there's any tumors that can't be targeted properly, I'll connect you with him, and he will be able to remove them. Now, the other thing too is you don't want to rely only on the tumor DNA sequencing. You also would greatly benefit from having the latest brain tumor sample, having RNA expression testing for that. I would highly recommend that, because it could open the door for all kinds of different targets. You don't know what sort of mutations. Maybe he has an ALK mutation, and you know, you can get some years out of the ALK inhibitors. There's a host of different mutations or overexpression that are not going to be found in a standard tumor DNA sequencing panel. So I think it's really important to have tumor DNA sequencing as well as expression testing.
Okay. My question is, can the mutation change throughout the disease time?
Yes. Yes, definitely. That's why you become resistant.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that the old mutation. So when you have a cancer, what happens is there's a variety of different mutations. And what happens is, think of it as, I like to use the bus, the driver and the bus analogy. So think of cancer as a bus that's driving down the highway, and you have a driver that is driving the bus, and then you have a bunch of passengers in the bus. So what happens is you hit it with a drug that targets the mutation, the driver, and the bus pulls over, the driver gets up and sits down in the passenger seat. And then all of a sudden, one of the passengers gets up and goes into the driver's seat and starts driving the bus again. So what you need to find out now is, what is the new driver? Which previous passenger is now driving the bus? And then you need to target that, because it's the new driver.
Okay.
And you would do that through both genetic testing and expression testing. But more likely in your situation, it would be through expression testing.
Okay.
Thank you for watching CTOM TV. Subscribe below and stay informed.